Thank you so much, Phil, for bringing us into worship. Welcome to worship here at Mulholland. So glad that you're here. I hope you all smelled that suckling pig out there. We're going to have a good time, a pig roast. Someone just said, I didn't know you were going to have a real cochon delay. I thought it might be fake, but no, it's the real deal. And it's going to be a lot of fun. We have games and different things for all of us to do. So I hope you'll stay after and be a part of that. One thing on here is that in the bulletin, our service is going to be a little bit different than usual. And on there, it says children's church. No children's church today, though, just so y'all are aware of that. No? You want to do children's church?
Yeah.
All right. Then we're going to do children's church today. All right. Rhonda.
Good morning. It is so nice to see all of you all here. We do have some more announcements. We try to get together once a month and go out to eat lunch after the 11 o'clock service, but this coming Sunday, we are going to do things a little different. We are going to go up to the second floor on the big, huge wall screen and watch the Saints beat the Indianapolis Colts. And we will... And we're going to serve pizza and wings and salad for those who don't like pizza and wings, and just enjoy one another and watch the game. So I hope you can join us. I want to personally thank all you cookie angels for coming up with 88 dozen cookies for me to take to Kairos. Well, I've already dropped them off for Jan Schluter and I to go into the prison this coming Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We only needed 44 dozen, but when I got to the team meeting yesterday where I had to drop my cookies off, two ladies did not have their cookies because they don't have a church family that's so awesome like you guys. So we were able to bless four volunteers to bring cookies into the prison. And if you think about us, please pray for the ministry of Kairos, number 50 at LCIW this Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And then our own Alameda, which is in the balcony, she's in the balcony. She is expecting her and Ade, their second child, and Dumade is right beside her. And we are going to have a baby shower for her and bless her with diapers, diapers, diapers. So that is going to be on November the 11th from 10 to 11:30 in the parlor. All ladies are welcome. Excuse me. And bring Pampers. She likes Pampers. So bring some diapers, and we're going to celebrate this new life coming into the world. And last but not least, right in front of you is a yellow Connect card. Take that out. Fill out as much information as you are willing to share so we can stay in touch with you. And there's a place for your prayer requests on the back, and we do faithfully pray for those every week.
Thank you, Rhonda. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for this beautiful day. It reminds us of your many blessings, blessings that we see and give thanks for, and so many others that we do not know, but you are working around us. We give you thanks. We come as your people to sing praises, to pray, to hear your word once again spoken to us. So come by your Holy Spirit and do a new work within us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's share now the peace of Christ with each other. The peace of Christ be with you.
You join with me, church, as we sing hymn number 1, Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing.
Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glory. my God and King, the glooms of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of Thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, His blood availed for me. He speaks and listening to His voice, new life the dead receive. The mournful broken hearts rejoice, the humble poor believe. Hear Him, ye deaf, His praise, ye dumb, your loosened tongues employ. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and leap ye lame for joy. In Christ your head you then shall know, shall feel your sins forgive, anticipate your heavenly love, and know that love is heaven. Look unto Him, ye nations own, your God, ye fallen race. Look and be saved through faith alone, be justified by grace. Glory to God in praise and power, be ever, ever give. By saints below and saints above, the church and is in heaven.
Church, would you stand as we sing our next hymn, number 8, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. We'll sing verses 1 and 2.
Joyful, joyful, we adore Thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before Thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All Thy works with joy surround Thee, earth and heaven reflect Thy rays. Stars and angels sing around Thee, center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, fiery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in Thee.
I'd like to invite Sarah Kreitzinger forward. It's such a beautiful thing that God has blessed us to be able to raise up leaders in the church. And Sarah, tell us a little bit about the Susie May Munholland Scholarship Fund, the committee, and what you've been doing.
Okay, thank you. It's just so wonderful to see what's happening in this church through the world, and we thank you so much. When I heard you this morning at the early service, I thought, here I am crying on Celebration Sunday because your witness is so powerful, but thank you very much. Anyway, as Jonathan says, I'm Sarah Kreitzinger, and I am here on behalf of the Susie May Munholland Scholarship Committee with great news that does fit in with all of our celebrations today. As many of you know, since we've been operating for 38 years, I hope you know, that the scholarship committee offers two very, very generous scholarships with financial aid for our Munholland Methodist members. The first is the Kuhn Scholarship, dedicated for graduate education, and I'm reading here, for men and women, that prepares them for church work in the fields of, but not limited to, Christian education, sacred music, and or the ordained, commissioned, or certified leadership in Wesleyan-rooted Methodist churches and their approved associates. And the second award is for the Wesley Christian Educational Scholarship, and that's set aside, listen to this, for junior and senior high students and adults, because we're always learning, who are interested in attending a specific Christian education experience that will help them discern a call to ministry and or leadership in a related Christian field. So we do have those scholarships available. If you're interested in applying for either of these awards, please see one of our committee members. Please raise your hand. We had several in the early service. Oh, and there's Mike and back there. Please see any of us. But if you miss us, go on the website, pull out an application, fill it out, get it to us. And we'll do the rest, and we work very quickly. So, please feel free to apply. And I also have to add, as part of my duties, is that we also welcome any financial donations that God calls you to provide. At the first service, after the first service, a woman came up to me and she said, "I've been listening, and I want to give you some money." And even though I was getting ready to teach Sunday school class, I stopped and listened. So anyway, and so we was just really, really happy that God had touched her in that work. And I can assure you, every single penny goes for our purpose. So today, and as I said, part of the celebration, we are so pleased to announce that we have two recipients for the Coombs Scholarship. This is the one that sends people into professional or graduate ministry. And the two are Jolie and Owen Trotter. Now, I introduced Jolie at the early service only to find out from her husband that she is sick and is not here. So we do wish her well. But let me tell you a little bit about her anyway. Jolie is a first-year graduate student in sacred music at the New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. You'll recognize her because she's director of our children's choir, helped in Vacation Bible School. I think Emily is also working with her. And of course, wherever Owen is busy doing things, you can bet that Julie is there with him. So even though she's not here today, I do want to let you know that we gave her a lovely, lovely scholarship, even if I do say so myself. Owen is a student at Asbury Theological Seminary. He's working on his Master of Divinity degree with plans to graduate in, keep trying to get him out earlier, but in 2025. Besides the great job he's doing as our wonderful worship leader and youth director, he has already started working as a supply pastor in the Global Methodist Church and is scheduled to be ordained in that denomination next year. And I might add that he's also already ordained in the Baptist denomination, so we're glad to have as many denominations as possible in our, because we learn from each one of them. So we're very proud of both of them and feel very, very blessed to be able to help them on their journey and their pathway into their call of ministries. Blessings. And I'm going to have Owen come up and speak just for a minute. Thank you.
Good morning, church family. Oh, you can do better than that. Come on. It's Celebration Sunday. Good morning, church family. There we go. It's good to be with you this morning, and I would like to extend on behalf of myself and my wife, thank you. Theological education, any education today is actually very expensive, as some of you know. And so this scholarship, this committee, this church, your work makes it possible for Jolie and I to go forward and to prepare not only for ministry here at Mulholland, but for ministry for years to come. And we are so incredibly grateful for this opportunity and so thankful to you for all that you have given and for all that you have done for the work of the committee and for this church as a whole. I've been told, we're so thankful to have you, and I I want to turn that around and say, I am so blessed to be here. I am so thankful to have the opportunity to serve you and to be able to be here and not only with your support, but with your kindness, just move forward in ministry to all the good things that God has for us as we move forward. So thank you so much. And now, at this time, it's time for our children to come down for Children's Church. So if there are any children for Children's Church, please come forward now. And would you stand as we sing our next hymn, hymn number 102, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less Than Jesus' Blood and Righteousness. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust us in his strength, but only on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood, so
be seated. And will you please pray with me? Great are you, Lord, and most worthy of praise. Your greatness no one can fathom. You are gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. By the power of your Holy Spirit, you strengthened us to remain obedient to your holy scriptures and given the joy that comes from not denying your word. You have shown yourself to be the God who guides, who sustains, and who causes us to run and not grow weary, walk and not grow faint. Though at times we felt like exiles, you did not abandon us or forgot your purpose for us. Truly, you have been faithful to us. What can we say but that we are so, so grateful? And as your people who are called by your name, may we continue on the narrow road, never veering to the right or left, but walking the way which leads to life. May we never tire of telling others why we have the hope in Jesus. Guide us, Lord, in all our ministry and missions that disciples are made here in Metairie and around the world. Father, there are those among us who are sick and who are grieving. Please bring healing. For those in our families and friends who do not see the need for you, show yourself and give them faith. For all our missions partners, equip them for even more ministry and keep them safe. For the persecuted church, be their protector and defender. For the children in our care, make yourself known. And Lord, we do not forget the war in Ukraine and now in Israel. Protect the innocent. Make a way for them to leave and bring this war to an end and bring peace. And now let us pray the prayer you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
like to invite the ushers to come forward. As we worship God with our voices, we worship God in service, we also worship God with our resources. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for many blessings poured out in our lives. Thank you for this congregation of your people. We thank you for the love and mercy you've shown to us. And we're reminded that you give us the very gifts and ability to produce wealth, as you say in Deuteronomy. So, Lord, receive these gifts, symbols of our lives, as we commit them once again to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Jeremiah chapter 29. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Well, we have a triple celebration today. We're celebrating Munholland's 87th birthday. On this date, 87 years ago, this church was birthed. We're also celebrating with the new year, 2024. This is Celebration Sunday, where it's the culmination of our stewardship, our prayer, asking God how He wants to use us in the coming year. You've probably received a little pamphlet which came in the mail, and we do have extras in here at the back in the front of the sanctuary if you would like to pick one up as you leave. But this is about our committing to 2024, what God is doing here. He is doing something really, really special. And so I encourage you, you look at that. Inside there are some little cards here. One is for giving, one is for serving, to figure out where God wants to use you in the year ahead. A lot of people have been asking, what can I do, John? Because there's that sense of we are beginning all again. What can I do? Well, here are areas of service, and like I said, people will call on you, and the answer is always what? Yes, let's say. So if I ask you to do something, you're going to say?
Yes.
Come on. What are you going to say?
Yes.
Excellent. Great. So if I ask you, or if Owen or Ann or Rhonda say, hey, you know, we're doing this great ministry and we need someone to help out, you are going to say,
yes.
Excellent. Love to hear that. So thank you for the offer. So fill that out. And if you don't fill it out, we're still going to call on you because there is too much good work ahead. And then also the card for giving. We build our budget on this offerings that you give, and we'll be giving this day and over the next several weeks as people return these cards. This is an opportunity for you to step up to tithing, to completely undergird through the gifts that God's blessed you with, to undergird ministry that is going on, not just within the walls, but so much more beyond the walls of this church. And so I encourage you to prayerfully, if you have not already, to prayerfully ask God how you can serve and how you can give to make the ministry of Munholland expand. So we are going to have an opportunity later in the service to give our tithes, to give our service pledge to the Lord. And we'll be bringing them down and putting them in the church here up front. That's part of the celebration. And I want to put that aside now, because we're celebrating that God is doing something new here. It is something beyond any one of us individually. It is something that started 87 years ago. We are here in the church called Munholland. Everybody I ask, you know, if you know the church, oh yeah, Mulholland. They can never say it right. But we're Munholland. Why are we Munholland? Because there was a pastor and his wife, Susie, her last name was May, became Munholland, and the pastor, Reverend Munholland, who served all around Louisiana and served here. She was somebody who loved the Lord and always wanted to be in service. She remembers when she was a little child, and she was a member of one of the smaller churches here in New Orleans, and then Rain Memorial, this big church was going to be built on St. Charles to be this big beacon of work of the Lord here in New Orleans. And she, along with all these other churches, they went to celebrate this new beginning of what God was going to do through Rain. And she remembered sitting there and listening and how thrilling it was. And she became a member there because she lived nearby. She did service in the Irish Channel. And there were a lot of immigrants that were coming in. And she said, there is ministry to be done here to help these immigrants. And so she asked God how she could serve. And she served for many years as a young lady there in the Irish Channel, doing amazing work. Well, as she grew a little bit older and she settled in this area, she said to the hierarchy of the Methodist Church, "We need a church. We need to plant a church here in Metairie." And they said, "No, we don't need to plant a church in Metairie. There's nobody out there." You know, the name Metairie means field. That's all it was.
Farm.
Field, farm, marshes. I mean, it was just alligators and swamp grass, right? And yet, she said, "We need a church here." I mean, everything was, you know, right at the level of sea level, except for Little Metairie Ridge, which is a couple feet above sea level. You know, that's where people were starting to build, and then it expanded out. But she knew that this area was going to be growing, and there needed to be a church here. So she said, "Hey, would you help me plant this church? I want to be a part of it. I'll be one of these early members to support it." And they said no. She kept after them. She got some other people saying, "We need a church here." And finally, they said, because of this persistent lady, said, "Yes, okay, you've worn us down. We'll build a church." There were 33 people who were the founding members of this church, Munholland. I want to name them just because, you know, we need to honor those who are willing to step forward to do something new of God. They had no idea what it was going to look like, but they had trust that God had a plan for them, for a hope and a future, something that would outlast them, something that would go way beyond their imagination, that would do more than they could ever do themselves. And they trusted God with that. And these are the families: W.D. Corbin, the A.B. Barber family, the Devon family, the Gilmore family, Betty Hay, Asta Johnson, the Mordenbach family, Susie Mae Munholland, the Petty family, the Ryan family, the Shepherd family, the Shield family, Alma Tubb, the Smith family, and they were led by Reverend Jolly Harper. I love that name, Jolly Harper. You know, so he was someone who was excited about ministry, came to be a part of this new church plant, and they all together had this vision that they were going to fulfill, that God had planted on their hearts. It was in the late 1930s, 1938, when it began. Think about that. That was in a time of Great Depression. That was the time when war was starting to rage in Europe, and yet they had hope that God was doing something new in the midst of that hardship. And then in 1941, the year before we were involved in the war through Pearl Harbor, we were already involved in other ways. War was in full bloom in Europe, and it was a terrible time, and they said, "We need to build a church." They met at Metairie Ridge High School, just down the road. They met there until a couple of years later. They said, "We need to build a church where people can gather. People can gather in prayer and worship, where people can grow in discipleship." 1941, 2 years later, 1943, they built another bit of building which went beyond here into some offices, into Sunday school space. These are people who trusted God beyond anything that they could see. There was something bigger going on, and they were all excited to be all in. It was wonderful that in that time, they said, "God, you're leading us. We'll do this." It was very reminiscent of what John Wesley did. You know, God's always been building his church. The gospel of Jesus Christ is spread all around the world and continues to be spread around the world. In England, in the late 1700s, there was a man named John Wesley. And he started out in just a small group, like Munholland, started out in this small little group, giving themselves fully to God. They were willing to go to the prisons and had some prison ministry, just like Rhonda. When we talk about her going to prison, it's not as a prisoner. I don't know her earlier years, though. But it's to do work there, just like it is in the DNA, was in the DNA of John Wesley in that small holiness group, that Bible club. They grew from a small beginning, but John Wesley had the sense that God was doing something big. And so he persisted in service and reaching out, telling people about Jesus Christ, people giving their lives to the Lord and growing. It was interesting because that time was a time of great ministry, building free pharmacies, going into prisons, getting alms for the poor. They would go out and solicit alms for the poor. They also would go without meals so that they would have more money so that they can help people who did not have meals. It was an incredible movement. They gave themselves fully to it. It's interesting, John Wesley, when he was at the university at Oxford, he had 30 pounds, and it took 28 pounds for him to live on. And so those two remaining pounds he gave to ministry to help the people around him who were in need. Throughout his life, he and his brother wrote a book of hymns. He had publications to help people in medical need. They did all kinds of work and publishing essays, and so money came in. And when he made 90 pounds, and with 90 pounds, he would live on 28 pounds and give the rest away. As he reached the point where he was making 120 pounds, he lived on 28 and gave 92 away. He said, if he has more than 6 pounds to his name when he dies, he'll consider himself a robber. He said, I don't want to have money getting root in my life. Here was someone who was fully, utterly given to the work that God had placed upon him, that God had entrusted to him. You know, everything that we have, everything that God's given is a tool for how we're going to use it for the kingdom of God. The relationships, the people that he's entrusted us with, that we use our lives as tools for good and for grace and for blessing. The finances, we give that for the building up of other people. We are involved in serving to help those who do not have enough. There's so many ways in which the tools God's given us are not meant to serve ourselves, but to be used with those around us. Those who are in need of hearing the gospel, those who are in need of encouragement and help, helping each other to grow as disciples. Everything we have is a tool. And as we use that well, God blesses us with more. You know, John Wesley, he said, make all you can. Make all you can. Save all you can so that you can give all you can. That was the ethos of John Wesley. That was the ethos of this new movement that God had birthed through his faithfulness. You know, it's interesting. As our income increases, our standard of living increases, right? But also our standard of giving increases. Mary Kay and I have told you this before. When we first got married, we said, okay, we're committed to tithing. We'll always give 10%. And it started out, we were at poverty level, right? But we gave 10% to the church and to some other ministries that were important to us. And then as we made more, we were able to give more. See, God blesses us not only so we can raise our standard of living, but so we can raise our standard of giving in his name. I want to invite forward a couple people. You see, last week we joined as a congregation, the Global Methodist Church. We decided that the ministry that they are doing and encouraging the leadership that they're lifting up, their vision for ministry is our own vision. And so we voted to join the Global Methodist Church. But it has not come easily. It has been a long year and a half. And people who across here, I look out, so many dedicated people to help Mulholland come to where it is today. There are four key people that I want to recognize, just like we're recognizing those who started this church that became Mulholland Methodist Church. I want to recognize four leaders. I'd like to invite Mike Lepper, Elaine Wilson, Caroline Sanders. Caroline here too, let's hope. Okay, please come on forward. And also Sarah Kreitziger. She left. Well, come on up. I think they're out tasting the pig. Come on forward. Come on forward. Come on up here. These folks, I'm not going to bite. Come on. These folks have put untold hours into helping Mount Holland get to where we are. For a year and a half, they have utterly given themselves to this that God has entrusted them with. You have no idea, not just the hours, but what they put in spiritually in prayer, what they put in service, giving themselves wholly to the work of Mount Holland in this time that God has called us to. And so I want to recognize you all for your hard work. We have these Bibles that we got for you. They're ESV study Bibles, which are just excellent, have so many good notes and all, because y'all are students of the Word, and thought that you would like that. And it's inscribed, I'll find it here. This is to Caroline Sanders, Defender of the Faith. In recognition of countless hours of service to Mount Holland Methodist Church, well done, good and faithful servant, for Christ and his kingdom always. This is from Mount Holland. And Elaine Wilson, for countless hours of service, Defender of the Faith. Thank you. Mike Leppard, Defender of the Faith. Thank you on behalf of Mount Holland for all that you've done. And Sarah Kreitzinger, who is out tasting the pig somewhere. For 25 years, she has served in the Methodist Church at the highest levels all throughout the state, across the globe, and she has poured herself in to the Methodist Church and into Mount Holland as we have now become part of the Global Methodist Church. And so I wanted to recognize her, and so she has a Bible as well. Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you so much for these, your servants, who led the charge, who are willing to give themselves wholeheartedly for you, putting aside so many other things, not taking the easy route, but Lord, leaning in to your calling on their lives in this time. We give you thanks for them, ask your blessings upon them, and Lord, we lift up this church that they worked so hard for, that your plans and your promises would be fulfilled. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you.
Church, and as we make this recognition, there's one more person we need to recognize. He doesn't know I'm going to do this. Through all of this, not only have Mike, Elaine, and Caroline, and Sarah put so much time and energy, but our pastor has put so much time, energy, prayer over this church, and we are so, so, so grateful for you. And how you have stood for Mount Holland, how have you stood for the Word of God, we're thankful for you. So we didn't, you know, we know, you use your Bible. I didn't want to get you a big Bible, you know, because it's up and in the air and moving around. So we got you one. It's an ESV, and I got you a journal as well. This is from your staff. There's some notes written inside for you. But we just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for all that you put on the line. Thank you for all the work that you have done. It has not gone unnoticed, and God has multiplied it and will continue to multiply us as we move forward. Thank you.
What a journey it's been. Please be seated. Thank you so much. It's been an honor to be here in this time. Thank you for letting me be your pastor through all this. It's an honor. Thank you. Well, let's continue. Because you know what? God is doing something unbelievably new. There is a spirit going on, just thing after thing, which is affirming that this is a new beginning. Just like 87 years ago, it was the start of this church. And I am hearing from people who are excited. people who've had dreams, people are being spoken to through Scripture, who are saying, God is really doing something new here, and I want to be a part of it. I'm so thankful that I am. And those leaders that I recognize, and there's so many others who did so much. Again, thank you. Thank you from the heart of Munholland. Thank you for all that you've done. Munholland just joined the Global Methodist Church, and it is a denomination that really is same as the heart of Munholland. It is exciting to be a part of it, because God, just as it's starting this new denomination, as we're becoming a part of that, who knows the plans that God has? Who knows the hope in the future? But as for me, I am all in. We had a strategic planning meeting with our staff. We got away for a couple days. And during that time, we said, this is the year. We all know it. This is the year when God is going to do unbelievably more, and that we have to be all in 110% and to do whatever we can in His name to see what He will do with our efforts. And there is that sense across the congregation, and I'm so excited. I want to touch on four things just real quickly. We are called here as a congregation to connect deeply with God. That is fundamentally what it's about, bringing people into that rich relationship with Jesus Christ, calling people to put their faith in Him. You know, we live in a world where so many young families maybe have a distant memory of what it is to be in a church, what that's like, and we have many, many families who do not have any memory of what it is to be in a group of believers. It is so important that we call people into a relationship with Jesus Christ here in this church to come and to worship. Because you know what? Everybody wants to know the God who created them. Everybody wants to know why they were created, what they were created for. Everybody wants to go through life with a sense of meaning and a sense of purpose. And that is what God gives us, to call people into that rich relationship, because we all know that without Him, we cannot experience the grace and the full life, that abundant life that Jesus says He has come to give us. We are called to connect with God deeply, personally. We are also called to serve in the church and to serve in the world. We serve by going out, right? It's incredible the ministries that are done. You know, the United Women of Faith, a phenomenal organization of women who seek to serve the Lord. Just three Saturdays ago, they raised $25,000 for missions to serve outside the walls of this church. Let's give them a round of applause. That money is given 100% to 15 different ministries, both here locally and abroad. How beautiful it is that we as a church have that serving heart. It was evident when I first got here 7 years ago that this is a church that is the hands and feet of Jesus Christ, and we continue to be. And that's why we have that card where you can say, I'm in. How can I serve? We also are a people that grow together. You know, in the late 1700s, the Methodists, when John Wesley would call people into a relationship with Jesus Christ, he then called them into a relationship with other believers, because it's in those groups that we grow. It's in those groups where we care for each other, we pray for each other, we help each other figure out what it is that God wants to do in their lives. He called that practical divinity. How do we live out God's Holy Spirit, the divine at work in our lives? And finally, we're called to be leaders. Leaders that serve. Leaders that call people to Christ. Leaders that understand that everything that God has given them is entrusted to work for His kingdom. We're here to connect deeply with Christ. We're here to grow with each other, to serve the world, and to become servant leaders in His name. This is what we're called to do. And this is why we gather again today to say, Lord, what you have ahead of us, We're all in. This is not a time to be half-hearted and mediocre. This is not a time to be a Sunday Christian. This is a time just like those 33 people who said, we're going to be here, give everything we have to build God's church. This is such a time for us today. You know, all things are kind of culminating together. We've been through this journey and we've joined the Global Methodist Church. At the same time, we've been looking ahead to what God has in store for us in the year to come. And we have this time where we can commit ourselves to that. All in, all out, and forever. So in just a moment, you're going to have opportunity, my wife and I included, to come and to place our cards here in this little replica of Munholland, and to say a prayer of blessing for 2024. God is doing something new. I know I've said that already 50 times this morning, but he is. There's something stirring. He's calling us, and we are ready now for the harvest to come in. Come forward, give your offerings and to be consecrated for 2024. Take time here at the altar to lift up God's work to come. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you. Thank you that you have called us for such a time as this. Thank you, Lord, that we are privileged enough to come and to give of ourselves, our service in our finances for the undergirding of what you are doing. Help us, Lord, to continue to stay deeply connected with your Son, Jesus Christ, to grow together, to learn to serve, and to learn to lead like servants. We are yours, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you give to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory. To God be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And should I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. With his blood he has saved me. With his things he has done.
is for your glory that we have come here today. It's for your glory that we consecrate ourselves for what you yet have for us, because we know that you have a plan for us, a hope and a future, that you're going to do things that we couldn't even imagine now. You're going to do things, Lord, that go beyond our ability and will even outlast our time here on earth. Lord, to you be all the glory, now and forever. Amen. Let us go celebrate with a great feast outside.
Usually, if you put a mic around.